said, I am a student on single gene correction in the brain, where it matters most. I'm a neurologist at the National Health Institute for 15, 20 years, seeing how neurology single gene disorders have evolved over the years. Just briefly, my disclosure of TI, therapy trials and also consulting on therapy clinical development and some neurofilm diet therapeutics. Just to lay the land here, as most of you know, some of the papers affect humans across the lifespan. We see any generation occurring in infants, children, as well as adults, and affect everything from focal nervous system to spinal cord and brain and myofascial conditions. So the dystrophies, these are inherited white matter disorders of the brain that form in this picture here on the right, where you see a normally well-formed brain that is now deteriorating due to a progressive brain disorder. As we learn about these different single gene disorders on next generation sequencing and newborn screening and bringing this to the fore, families are coming to our clinic and asking for ways to treat this, what are the appropriate approaches to gene therapy. You see highlighted here in vivo gene therapy as well as ex vivo gene therapy, highlighting the differences here between the direct delivery of in vivo gene therapy and convenience of the approach as opposed to ex vivo gene therapy that is using the lentiviral approach. And I will not be having the time to speak about this, but it's a nanoparticle gene therapy that we can put together to discuss. So how are in vivo and ex vivo gene therapy different? The one uses a small gene-associated viral vector that can cause a vector to work on the other is a lentiviral vector, which was comprised of larger genes. And the fundamental difference is that the lentiviruses are very good at transfecting medical stem cells and using medical reconstitution, especially on the right, whereas the Zier cultures are directly injected into target organs such as brain, spinal cord, spinal fluid, and therefore allows for much quicker direct delivery. I will argue here in these next few minutes that depending on the specific injury and specific gene that is targeted, we need to think about the selective variability of the brain, the cell type involved, not one size fits all. Disorders such as hypomyelination to improve people dramatically from inflammatory MIF to the fluid LRD. And even the same gene that affects fluid LRD in adulthood causes a hereditary spastic paraplegia, meaning we need again a different approach to target spinal cord and long term. And then I'll close by speaking briefly about Canada and the spongiform encephalopathy. And often by understanding where those genes are expressed without developing those treatments. So let me kick it off by talking about recent types of spastic form activity, a devastating disorder that we've known about for more than 100 years. Most of these children have families succumb to the disease within 4 to 5 years. We know that we can detect early on the red spots that the symptoms often become quickly defined in the pathology with very fading features. Two genes, HexA and HexB, that are responsible for creating gametes. Now, the rationale for our approach with thalamic delivery of A, B, T, and T came about from the Delta Sylvester. We managed to find that if we targeted the thalamus and took advantage of the So that if we deliver this into particularly for ideas that could get into the right cell types in the brain. We know if we're able to deliver to the right compartment of the cells, then you can cross the zone. And we know it takes a long time to have the acid effects of these. So with this piece of concept work, we want to try to think of it as a small pump of the human delivering to the spinal cord. So we think that we can impact patients in that trauma and then moving forward and also try to start this trauma in the hospital and helping this kind of slow infusion into the patient's dose by numbering to people delivering. And then the family is already arriving to the ratio and have their family members enrolled and help to prevent their kids with disability. Moving from the A&B and B of the Cico approach to the other two approaches that I wanted to mention, intravenous in the last of those. And I feel I'm going to call out on the tricholamic and in particular the rationale for using intravenous AAV9 after therapy with the dog is right from the cow. We showed in multiple animal models that you could effectively deliver young mice by intravenous route to the brain of cattle animals. This is the same percent of energy form encephalopathy that these mice are using today and prevent neurological decline. And this has to do with delivering not just to all the endocytes, but to the endocytes. And importantly, it shows even with the visual directed promoter, this was quite effective in showing the value of systemic delivery in shareholders and how to be conducted in the gene therapy and treatment for certain cannabinoids. This is just to highlight some of the young children that are going through this. Here, within each human type of some of the gene disorders of the brain, there's the target structures and cells that are important to the disease biology. And brain diseases will likely be the cause of prominent. We think that type 3 of gene therapy could help reconstitute those myeloid cells, including the brain health, spinal cord disease, where there's no disruption of the brain barrier. We often use an AAV gene therapy approach in particular, and then if it goes in ganglia, we can have connectivity to peripheral and central nervous system. We think also that the network of other farmers is important to allow the kind of solution and connectivity into the flow of the two overall routes of gene therapy delivery makes a difference, and we need to bring those technologies together with the right biology. Just to highlight that we have scholarship in neurogenetics and gene therapy that is attending as a fellow to not only implement trials or phase of the trial, knowing how the structure is monitored and how it's set, is key to success. And I think I always emphasize that the community here comes first, and a big shout out to all the patients and families that can participate in that trial. And moving forward, we think our role is not just to bring the therapies forward, but to build community so that patients are not under acute disease, but also understand the ups and downs of some of our treatment strategies that we use. Some things work, many things don't work, and knowing that there's resilience in the community and that patients and families understand that is key. So, thanks, if you have lots of good questions.
And maybe wanted to spend a couple of minutes on some of the specific comments of how the gene therapy is delivered. What do you think goes into making that decision? Does it matter based on what indication you're trying to look at, whether certain disease might be better than others? And then to follow up on that, you're focused on AAV9. There's a few companies that have been using AAV9 as their approach to treat multiple different indications as well as AAV8. And in recent years, for the last 2 to 3 years, there have been at least focused by the FDA on potential safety concerns of using AAV8 approaches. And so I would love to hear your thoughts on why you think safety is or isn't an issue using this approach, and what might be the root cause. So I think that's actually a good question.
So safety is always first and foremost on the mind of treating physicians, treating patients, and patients. We want to first know that we can do this safely. We also know that not in many of these devastating disorders, the risk of those disorders is in favor of treating many of these children and patients who are the way I think of the appropriate choice of delivery route is very much based on the biology, and I hope I've been able to demonstrate that. It's what cell types are you targeting? Are they rather open or not? Often, that is open early in life, but so we are trying to something we have to wait for every disease and every child separately. There is often vulnerabilities that we consider in often terms here. Often we go to sit up and sort of stand or walk and talk. So then we are particularly worried about the timing of this as well, and I think that's focus on things.
So as a practicing physician, how would you view the need to be steroid process and side effects of the difference? Well, a little bit of a debate about, you know, how long you should be the patient to be steroid and you start something versus the risk reward that you feel comfortable. It seems like you do, but how would you describe the feeling of your colleagues in general?
Yeah, I mean, it, again, it depends on the situation. So if you're
I think we're still at the infancy of gene therapy as a treatment for neurodegeneration. One thing that, people I speak with often ask about is, what's your definition of gene therapy? Is it something that cures permanently, or is it something that can meaningfully slow down progression of the disease to the point where, you know, you may not need to be dosed as in practice again? Hypothetically, that would be, you know, what's that? Where do you think the time is on the therapy? Do you know for sure that when you administer a treatment, let's say for SNL, which is a version of DMD with a few more choices in it, that that would be a more than done and that would be a
few days? Yeah, I think the aspiration and the hope is to go to treat that if it wasn't done. But I think it's better if it's not as well as it can be done.
What do you think about safety? So, again, we only have a handful of drugs that are approved and that are working famous for using it for years, but another big topic of discussion as well with people is, when do you know what the gene therapy is to be safe? And how many years out after treatment can you feel comfortable that we know what the side effects of that is?
The majority of the disease at the time, trade. And if we think about how long term scalability and often,
So when we do talk to the families about options that we have in the country, and we do think it's something that could be available, how do you think they think about the pros and cons of that? For instance, you mentioned one of these budget efforts, which would be kind of different. So how do you, in my mind, when I say I would just think, well, here is something that's different. Is it better or is it just that how people are thinking?
I think, families do have an appetite, and I think my family's family took a sort of adaptation to test the comments we did. And the appetite for it wasn't done. And I think that is amazing. One of the structured features of Neurology is a single administration, and it's fantastic to be able to do the administration. And even though it's the other side of the planet, the downside is that we face challenges around optimization, there are some side effects, and I'm just going to raise this to my decision what to do. As a physician, what I try to do is open up new doors and new options, saying that the worst thing is looking back into what we were facing for 100 years, which is no options, and we could try to come looking back. But I think we are headed into a good place.
I do want to open up the floor to any questions. I just want to see what I'm going to do. I have a question for the microphone.
I'm curious whether you feel that it's utility in studying the brain's own mechanism as well as how it moves towards acetylcholine, especially in the setting of particular administration. There's a lot of work about the kind of static flow and ways to enhance that, especially as you talk about distributing to the broader networks that we get into the study. Is that relevant for how we think about delivery of these diseases and the sense that the comfort of the skin, the mode of administration, and the understanding that we don't want to get into the skin?
No, I absolutely. I think for 10 years we'll be looking back and smiling about our early attempts at putting patients into some outdoor position or getting them up to walk around and accelerate heart rate to move CSF around. So I do think in future having more quantitative measures and ways to continue to monitor this and understand distribution will be key. So has reworked a lot of the modern metaphysics studies. But, you know, I think you might be the center that would be maybe an opportunity to think of the questions. I would like to think of you about that. I think the cardiologists are probably ahead of us in terms of the dynamics of imaging and real-time imaging.
Thank you.
first meetings and seeing that progression before exploring aspects of the future. Yeah, one of the several interesting areas is one,
So maybe I want to follow the topic of working for you mentioned it again about what I do guys want to talk about. Do you think that that's enough time? And do you think that the agency can change it to what I want? And maybe if you have a question for the what do you do with the accelerated path to approval because many of these conditions
some of the guys that we keep with, and the things that we're doing here is Clinical question. I think that's also an evolving landscape, and every decision indication is different. I think that we are implementing more and more everything that we think of doing in the studies for every indication. I don't think so, but I think that needs to be carefully weighed. I think the non-implementing do not reflect the genetic condition itself. So you have to understand that you are just putting something facing and accomplishing and guidance, why is that discussion? So it has limitations, and I think FDA is allowing more and more non-genetic data as well. I think having some understanding of biodistribution is often needed, and that's where the work is more important. Hi, Dr. Eichler. I'm not French, but Dr. Eichler is my science. You were asked earlier how to family way the person talking about. Certainly, I can't speak for families in general, but I can speak for myself. My daughter is when we got the diagnosis last year, my partner and I started reading it, of course, and even though we're the same thing, we didn't say anything. And as you immediately see the Google results, and they're all over the place, you know, like our families are part of it, for everything. So, you know, when you're asked, how do families weigh the personal comments, my family, certainly you know the personal comments would be. We're going into this with a nice wide open, but we know what we know what the path is when it's not in this way. And that path is all fun. So to have something, wonderful that we can put our time of comfort, give us an easy choice. And I think it's important for all of you all, and just hear whatever you are. I apologize, I'm not from this world, I'm just a lowly lobbyist in the area. But, please remember that these are real people. That's what being a true victim and real families. And the impact, we hope, whatever the impact is, we know that my role in this for families, you know, as much for her as to help other kids with this situation. And we embrace that, but this is real, and the kids are there. Can't take a question from a family perspective. This is, you know, it wasn't really a choice. It was something, and so we're going to start. Yeah, that's a good answer. You don't like that.
Okay, so I have a few more. Maybe to just pick up on some of the topics that we briefly touched upon in the last few minutes. How are you thinking about the importance of the disease that you're treating to treat it in one way? Can there be a place for gene therapy in diseases that are, you know, polygenic, but there's one aspect of the disease itself that could be beneficial for you to use a gene therapy approach? Because up until now, there's been definitively monogenic. So, the salary is a straight approach.
Yeah, I certainly have not seen that on the clinical side yet. I think there is a lot of that could be on the preclinical side of what you're thinking beyond modulating the disease causing genes, modulating transcriptional pathways, other common networks of genes that might be working together and allow for outcomes where you could think of causing a single gene there's a certain part of me that says, well, if it's a network of different things that is polygenic, then you have to appropriately answer that and do the first clinical trial. So I would say, if you make an argument, you have to introduce gene correction on several different genes in that case. We're doing that right here for a transaction. So I'm not actually going to know how to work together in order to lower the value of that. So there is some confidence for that, but it is still a value of that.
Do you think that for Alzheimer's or for ALS, autism, there could be a place for combination therapies, let's say with an ALS family and the gene therapy, similar to an oncology or anything like
that? Yeah, I mean, I think there's a treatment for that. I would certainly suggest that I think about it in the right way. Thank you.
Where do you think the space for data comes from?
I think publishing our hope that as you really could have been more options for patients. I think that's why
I can grab from, so thanks everybody.